The following audio may contain the personal testimonials of Take Shape for Life health coaches or clients. The results relayed in these messages are based on the unique experiences of the participants, and we cannot guarantee like or similar outcomes. While you may be inspired by these accounts, please note that any stories of success have not been verified, and your individual path to healthy living and weight loss will vary. As always, it is our recommendation that you consult with a physician before starting a weight loss program. Yours in health, the Take Shape for Life team.
Welcome to the Take Shape for Life Habits of Health call. I'm Shirley Mast. I'm a certified health coach, and it's my pleasure to host this call for you. Now, if this is your first time joining the Habits of Health call, a special welcome to you. I know for some of you, this is your very first time, and we're delighted that you're here. This call is designed for Take Shape for Life clients, coaches, health professionals, but you might not fit in any of those categories. You might just be here because you're interested in learning more about our program and how to create better health. So regardless of how you come to this call this evening, we're really glad you're here. Now, you might hear content that's geared towards those that are in various stages of their health journey. Some will be in the weight loss phase of their health journey. Some will be in transition. Some will be in the optimization phase where they're moving forward to a lifetime of optimal health. And regardless, Take Shape for Life offers excellent tools and support for people anywhere in that journey. We've got great tools for those that are interested in weight loss, but we've got a lot to offer for anyone who's looking for better health in any area of their life. So if you are in the weight loss phase yourself right now, maybe you're on our Optimal Weight 5-in-1 plan, please be sure to follow the guidelines that has been set up for you as guided by your free health coach. Now, you'll be pleased to know, especially because I know the content that's coming up tonight, you'll be pleased to know that this webinar is being recorded and it will be available on your health coach's co-branded website as well as on our YouTube channel and podcast within the next 48 hours. So if you're looking for this on YouTube, search Habits of Health Zoom. And for podcasts, you can just open the podcast player of your choice and search for Take Shape for Life. Now, for those of you that are listening to the podcast or the recording later, we are so glad you've taken the time to do that. And we invite you to join us live next time to be part of the discussion. These Habits of Health support webinars are held every Wednesday evening at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time. And you can check out your health coach's co-branded website for the link. So with no further ado, I am really delighted to introduce to you our speaker for this evening. I've heard him speak on several occasions, and I always learn so much. So I'm delighted that Nick's taken the time to be with us. This evening we have with us Nick Fry. He is a Take Shape for Life's resident behavioral specialist, and he's a licensed clinical professional counselor and national certified counselor specializing in behavioral weight loss, disordered eating, motivation, and health behavior change. So he works with our nutritional support team, supporting Take Shape for Life health coaches and providing them with information and recommendations on how they can more effectively coach their clients through emotional and behavioral challenges. And I'll tell you, he's personally been a huge asset to me, not only in my own health journey, but as I'm supporting my clients. So Nick, I am just so delighted to have you here with us this evening. I'm going to turn it over to you because I can't wait to hear what you've got for us this evening.
Well, thank you so much, Shirley. And hi, everybody. As Shirley said, my name's Nick, and I'm the behavioral specialist here with Take Shape for Life. So we are going to be talking about, obviously, some emotional, some behavioral, some psychological stuff tonight, because I really feel like this is an incredibly important part of our health journey on our way to optimal health. So tonight, specifically, we're going to be talking about emotional eating. We're going to be talking a little bit about what it is, how you can identify it, and if you are an emotional eater, if you identify yourself as one, how can we overcome it utilizing the tools that we already have available to us. So what we're going to do is I'm going to go through just a brief presentation, talk about some things. Shirley and I are going to talk about some things. You're going to get an opportunity to kind of interact in the chat box and share some of your information and stories and things like that. So let's go ahead and get started. I'm just going to share my screen here. Okay, so hopefully everybody can see that PowerPoint presentation right now. So what if I am an emotional eater? We're going to talk a little bit, as I said, about first what it means to be an emotional eater, what that's all about, and then what we can do So let's get going. So first off, we all experience many different emotions in our life, and I've listed just kind of some basic ones here, maybe anger, and some synonyms for that are disrespected, frustrated, pressured. We also experience fear, anxiety, worry, stress. How about sadness, disappointment? Maybe we feel really stuck or tired. And then on the other end of the spectrum, joy. We might feel confident, energized, excited. And I want to make sure that I point that one out specifically, because when we typically think about emotional eating, we think, I'm upset, so I eat, or I'm anxious, so I eat, or I'm sad, so I eat. But we can also be happy and choose to eat as well. So just wanted to make sure that we keep that in mind as well. We can celebrate with food and things like that. And that is emotional eating. So emotional eaters, if you identify yourself as one, or maybe you've been thinking about it, we tend to seek out comfort foods when experiencing strong emotional states. And that's because these comfort foods provide pleasurable and calming effects. They either feel good or they feel really relaxing, right? And over time, as we seek out these comfort foods, it links the change in our mood with the experience of eating. This literally rewires our brain. We begin to think about, if I eat that, I feel better, or I feel relaxed, or I feel good. And then our bodies and our brains come to expect and even demand comforting foods, causing the urge or the craving to eat anytime we feel really strong emotions. So I know that I've personally experienced this. Shirley, what about you? Have you ever experienced this where you have this urge or this craving for some kind of comfort food?
Oh my goodness, I was the queen of that, you know? And I think you and I have talked about this already. I used to feed every single emotion. You know, it's really interesting that you talked about that. You know, a lot of people will think about, well, when I'm stressed out, when I'm unhappy, I'm really, you know, that's the time that I really pig out. And it was interesting for me to observe within the past couple of years, within the past several years, my mother passed away and we had sons get married. Now, the one, of course, was a very sad situation, but, you know, having our sons get married was just delightful. We were thrilled, okay? I struggled more with my weight and with stress eating during those happy times than I did during the year that my mom passed away, possibly because I was more cautious. You know, I knew, oh, this is a really sad time. My guard was up. But when I was having a party, man, I wanted to eat. It was intense joy. And it's been kind of an interesting journey for me to learn how to rewire that.
Yes, yes. I'm so glad that you pointed that out, because that's such an important thing for us to understand, that really food is tied to emotions and feelings in general, regardless of their happiness or sadness or frustration or whatever it is. We really have this very strong connection between food and mood. So absolutely, I can definitely relate to you on that. So this rewiring of our brains, where we come to expect food when we have these strong emotions, this expectation begins to drive our actions and the pursuit of food. The food makes us feel better, right? Or, you know, even in the sense of joy, even more joyful. We're celebrating with food, things like that. And this strengthens the association between our mood and the experience of eating food. Now, this association, the more we do, the more we eat in response to our emotions, the more this becomes a pattern or a habit in our life, the more likely we are to seek out food the next time we experience strong emotions. So it's this kind of practiced effect. The more we do it, the more likely we are to do it again, right? And so this creates what we call a vicious cycle, right? A vicious cycle. We've heard this term before. And let's take a look at what that actually looks like, because a vicious cycle is also known as a habit. Now, if you're familiar with Dr. A's book, Stop, Challenge, Choose, the ebook, he talks a lot about this habit loop in there. And we're going to break this down for those of you who aren't familiar with it, and then we're going to see how emotional eating actually fits right into this vicious cycle or this habit loop. So that habit loop contains four components: the cue, the routine, the reward, and the craving. And you can see the craving in the middle there is like the engine that kind of keeps this habit going, right? A cue is kind of like a trigger, or the thing that sets off this behavioral pattern. The craving is the thing we experience, that drive, that expectation, that urge or that desire. The routine is eating, right? It's the behavior or the routine that we do. And then the reward is the thing that we get. And that reward is actually what then strengthens the craving, strengthens the associations between the cue and the routine, and drives us and motivates us to continue this behavior. So let's take a look at how emotional eating fits into this habit. So the strong emotion, that's the cue, that's the trigger. So whether we feel fearful, happy, sad, angry, whatever strong emotions we feel, that drives us to eat, go to that the comfort food. The comfort food then provides some kind of pleasure or relief. That reward is tied back to the change in our emotion. That creates the craving, which again motivates and drives this loop over and over and over again. So I'll give you an example here. If you have a really stressful day at work, your boss is hounding you, or you have a big project coming up, or you had hit a lot of traffic and you were late for work that day, and your boss is like, "That's the second time this week," or something like that. I'm picking on bosses today for some reason. We experience some kind of strong emotion. Then we're driving home from this terrible day at work, and we pass by a fast food restaurant, and we think to ourselves, "You know what? That'll make me feel better." So then we eat, and we do temporarily feel better. We feel some sort of relief or some sort of good feeling. Later, we're going to feel awful, but in the short term, we feel that relief. And then that creates that craving the next time you see that fast food restaurant, next time you feel stressed, next time you feel angry or upset or sad, you remember, those French fries made me feel a little bit better. Maybe I'll do that again. And so then it just creates this habit loop over and over again, and we find ourselves stuck in this vicious cycle. So let's talk a little bit about emotional triggers. And I want you all right now in the chat box, which I think is either this way or this way, somewhere around there, talk about what your emotional triggers are. We talked a lot about the happy type stress with her family and her son's getting married and things like that. And that was an emotional trigger for her. I know for me, stress and anxiety is definitely my biggest emotional trigger. Shirley, would you say that kind of stress is your biggest emotional trigger?
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that. I find that for me, and it'll be fun to see what people say in the chat box as well, but I know for me, if I'm sad, lonely, that kind of like, sad, lonely, bored. I know more bored isn't an emotion, but it's kind of like, what am I going to do to make myself feel better? You know, those days where you come home and you're just sort of wandering around the house, not sure what to do with yourself. And often if I dig down into the emotion, that's probably a sad, lonely thing.
Yeah.
And somehow for a moment, I think the food's going to make that feel better. Actually, it does. For about, 3 red hot seconds, I feel better.
And that's it right there. That, interestingly enough, for our brains is enough. 3 red hot seconds of relief or pleasure or whatever is enough to actually develop this wiring in our brain that says, when you feel that way, eat this, you feel better, even if it's temporary.
I'll tell you, Nick, I've had the experience already where, especially as I started getting healthier, a lot of I've lost a fair amount of weight on this program. And so it was a journey, and it wasn't just the physical progress, but it was this mental progress that Nick's talking about. And I remember having an occasion in which I was eating a candy bar, not a big one, just your average size candy bar. First 2 bites tasted great. And the rest of the candy bar, because I was getting more aware, the rest of the candy bar tasted a lot like regret. It's like, I'm going to finish the candy bar because I started it, because, that's what I do as a formerly fat girl. That's what we do, but it wasn't, the pleasure was gone already. And that was a really good wake up call for me on, hey, this really is not helping me get what I really want.
Yeah, absolutely. And Shirley, what you just described there has a really fun psychobabble term called anticipatory reward. And interestingly enough, individuals that struggle with weight find the anticipation of eating more rewarding than the eating itself. And that's exactly what you just described. oh, this candy bar is going to be so good. 2 bites in, this isn't as good as I expected it to be. It tastes a lot like regret and guilt, as you described.
Well, you know, Nick, there's going to be a lot of people in this call that'll say, we knew Shirley was a little messed up anyway. but honestly, I would imagine, and we won't have a show of hands on this. You don't have to fess up in the chat box. But I would imagine that as Nick was talking about that, there's a lot of you that really resonated with that whole idea of, oh, I anticipate what I'm going to have. Oh, I'm going to go to this fast food place and I'm going to order this and this and this. And the great joy was in the anticipation. And once you actually get it and start to eat it, it's like, oh, yeah, it didn't quite give me what I thought it would give me.
Yes, exactly. Keep that in mind. That's going to be really important for when we start talking about how we begin to overcome this. So let's get into that a little bit. So first, let's learn how we're going to break this cycle. So there are a few very important things that we need to understand here. The first is what Shirley was just talking about. We need to change the expectations of emotional eating by drawing towards what you want and pushing away from what is no longer desirable. Drawing towards what you want is health. Optimal health, healthy eating, a healthy body, a healthy mind, and pushing away from what you don't want, temporary, unhealthy relief from how we feel. And then we want to create an alternative routine. And we're going to talk about how you do those two things using a very well-known tool, stop, challenge, choose. Now, if you're not familiar with this, I highly recommend that you pick up your Habits of Health book and go right to that chapter and start reading about this, because this is going to be your most powerful tool when we're talking about breaking this emotional cycle. So let's get into it a little bit and talk about what or how we utilize this. How do we use stop, challenge, choose to change the emotional eating expectations and to create a new and healthy routine? So take a look at that habit loop again. Now, notice what we have done here. We have only changed one thing in the habit loop. The strong emotion is still there, the craving is still there, and the pleasure and the relief, the reward, is still there. All we've done is swap out the routine. That's the golden rule of habit change. You change the routine while keeping the cue and the reward almost the same. So, how do we do this? Okay, so what happens? We experience a strong emotion. We experience this craving to eat. We stop, take a deep breath. Then we challenge that craving. We challenge it by pushing away from what we don't want and drawing towards what we want. So I've given you some examples here, and you can create your own little saying, but I highly recommend you create a saying and write it down. Here's just some examples here. Eating to comfort myself actually makes me feel more miserable. I feel great when I choose a healthy way to cope with my emotions. We challenge that thought process right there. Then the third step, we choose. We choose a healthy alternative routine that provides pleasure and relief. Then we experience that pleasure and relief. We begin to break the cycle and change the habit. Now, this is a very important thing to understand. We have to choose something that provides pleasure or relief. A lot of times people choose a healthy alternative routine that doesn't make them feel better or make them feel good. It's just not for them, or it doesn't provide them what it is that they're looking for, right? So I hear this a lot. Okay, you're experiencing a craving. Stop, challenge, choose, and go for a walk. What if it's freezing outside? What if it's raining? That's not pleasurable. That doesn't provide me with anything. Now I'm soaking wet and I'm freezing. I don't know where you guys here live, but I live in Maryland and it is cold right now. It is the middle of winter. So you have to make sure you choose something that's going to make you feel good. Now, Shirley, I see you laughing at that one. So is this something that you've experienced as well?
Our weather's a little miserable right now too. And I'm thinking, oh, please, Nick, don't tell me to go out for a walk. Well, I agree. I think there is really something about that whole thing of choosing something that is pleasurable for you. Now, Nick, this is not going to be on your list. I'll guarantee it. But I find that when I'm feeling stressed, for me, if I can give myself a homemade manicure, makes me happy. Okay. My fingers are busy. I can't eat when I'm painting my nails. And actually there's a period of time that they've got to dry, you know, So all the men on the call are going to say, well, that was totally worthless for me. But it is something that's pleasant for me. It lets me slow down. It lets me breathe. It lets me think. And it works for me.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Exactly. And okay, well, I'll give you one that isn't going to be on your list. Recently, I have developed an appreciation and really the joy of shaving. My wife got me.
You're right. That has never gotten on my list.
My wife got me a beautiful old safety razor and a brush and this shaving soap, just like my grandpa used to shave, right? And it's this wonderful self-care type of activity that I like to do, and it makes me feel better, and it takes the time, and my hands are busy, all those things that you just said. And it's actually become less of a chore to shave and more of a really relaxing and wonderful experience. So there's one for the men out there.
That's great.
So let's talk a little bit more about that, because I think that's where we're going next is, here we go, the healthy routine. So Shirley mentioned this might not be on your list. And what did she mean by that? Well, we have to develop a menu or a list of pleasurable and comforting activities. You need to take the time to write these down. Notice I've said write it down 2 times today. Don't just think about these things. Write them down. Put them out into the actual physical space. You want to create a list of options that you can use to obtain pleasure or relief from emotional distress. I like to call this the comfort menu, right? The comfort menu. So you need to create a comfort menu. Those things that make you feel good, that make you feel relaxed, or that enhance your joy even more, if we're talking about eating in response to joyous occasions. What can you do in replace of eating? So I provided just a few examples here of the comfort menu items. So it can include things like deep breathing meditation, positive imagery, squeezing a stress ball, giving yourself a hand massage. I also, it's a really great idea to have a stress-free zone to relax in. Like, where is it in your house or at your place of work or something like that, where you can go, just get away from it all, right? Spend time outdoors, if the weather's nice, right? Get in the sun, stretch, take a quick walk. How about listen to your favorite song? Write your emotions down, light some scented candles. Here's a really interesting one. Shirley, did you know that the smell of citrus and the smell of coffee is actually naturally anxiety reducing?
And that's why my coffee makes me so happy in the morning.
There you go. Yes, so you can, and actually my wife does this. My wife doesn't drink coffee, but she loves the smell of coffee. So if she's feeling a little stressed, she'll open up my bag of freshly ground beans, give a nice little whiff, and she feels better. and the last on my list here is talk to a friend or cuddle with a pet. I've got a dog and 2 cats. Shirley, do you have any pets?
I do. And actually, it's funny, right before we started recording this and getting started on this evening, just after we started, I realized mine is right underneath my desk. And so far, she's being quiet, crossing my fingers.
Yes, wonderful. And pets and are wonderful ways to reduce your stress. Take care of them. Maybe they need their nails trimmed or their coat brushed or something like that. And actually kind of taking care of them can be really, really wonderful as well. Or talking to a friend. So keep that one in mind as we kind of move on through this, because I'm going to talk a little bit more about that as well. So what's on your comfort menu? Let's take a little time to write in the chat box there, whichever way it might be. And what are some items that maybe you're going to add to your comfort menu? We've already kind of listed a few of ours. I think smelling coffee for me is one of those really fun ones. I actually do have a secret comfort zone at work. Nobody knows about it. I like to sleep in there.
You're not going to tell us here either, are you?
Nope. If you visit our home office, I will not tell you where it is. So those are some things that are on my comfort menu. Shirley, how about you? What are some things on your comfort menu?
Yeah, I am with you on the dog thing. You know, like the fact, part of the reason that this dog is so settled in under my desk is because when I need a break, she's on my lap. It may not matter to her, but it makes me feel better. Hey, yeah. And you know, one thing that I will mention, Nick, while people are adding those items to the chat box, because it's just so much fun to see different ideas. For those of you that have not yet had an opportunity to read Dr. A's Stop Challenge Choose book, ebook, it comes in an ebook format. We use it with all of our clients. So whoever invited you onto this call, get back in touch with them and say, hey, I was on this call. Shirley Mass said that you could get a hold of that Stop Challenge Choose ebook and get me a complimentary copy. And I am certain that they would be happy to do that so that you can read more of what Nick's been referring to this evening.
Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah, I have found that book personally helpful. It's a really, really great resource. All right, so I'm going to tell you all about my plan. So as I have previously mentioned, I'm a little prone to emotional eating when I feel anxiety, worry, stress, feeling overwhelmed, things like that. So I developed a habit. So whenever I experience anxiety, stress, or worry, I stop, take a deep breath, and here are my challenging thoughts. I challenge my thoughts by saying, eating to comfort myself will just make it worse. I actually feel better when I talk about my emotions. So I choose to talk with my wife, to talk to family, to talk to friends. And then I experience the sense of relief just being able to get things off my chest, to be able to express the stress or the anxiety or the worry that I feel. So instead of me running to those cookies or running to the ice cream, pizza and French fries. Oh, there it is. You guys got me to it. My comfort food is French fries. Before running to the French fries, I pick up the phone, or even texting helps me. Just texting my wife, man, I'm really stressed today. Or texting my father-in-law or another family member, my mom or a friend of mine, man, I'm really stressed out today. And just being able to say that and express how I'm feeling, I experience the sense of relief. And it's just a much healthier way to kind of deal with these emotions. So that's my plan that I've developed and I've worked really hard at it and I have found to that really works for me. Shirley, how about you? Have you kind of worked on a plan similar to this?
Yeah, I really have. And I found that it just became, because this whole concept of changing, and I don't want to go too long here. I know we're just about running out of time, but okay. This whole concept of changing the habits really, truly works. It's really possible. I mean, I was unhealthy for the vast majority of my adult life and have now really made some significant changes in this. And the reason I share that is to say, look, where you can say to yourself, look, if Shirley can do this, anybody can do this, because that's true. I found anything that I can do to help me stay mindful so that I will do the stop challenge. If I do the stop challenge, I almost always make the right choice. But sometimes I don't remember to stop and or to challenge it. And once I can do that, then I'm good. So I've had people that have just written stop, challenge, choose and hung it on the refrigerator door. You know, something to just keep your mind in the game.
Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah. And any kind of visual cue you can use, right? All right. Well, yeah, as Shirley said, we're just about out of time. So I'm going to finish up here. What is your plan? First and foremost, recognize which emotions trigger your eating. Is it anger? Is it fear? Is it sadness? Is it joy? Is it all of them? Create a comfort menu with healthy alternative routines that provide pleasure and or relief. And most importantly, write out the plan. Here's just a basic structure of how you can write out a plan. When I experience this emotion, I will choose an item from my comfort menu because it helps me feel relief and brings me closer to my health goal. Just fill in the blanks. Write it down, keep it with you, read it over. You can do it. And Shirley, that's all I have for everybody today. So I want to wish everybody good luck in creating your plan to overcome emotional eating.
That was super, Nick. That was just, I would imagine we're going to get a lot of feedback after this evening on how much this has been helpful. I know my clients always love getting an opportunity to hear from you. And I would encourage those of you that are on the call, I would encourage you to share with whoever invited you onto the call, whether it was your health coach, maybe it was a friend, share with them one thing you learned. I mean, write down what you've learned because that's where the learning lies. You know, that's where the benefits will lie. But also share with them one thing that you've learned. Maybe share with them one of the things that's on their comfort menu because maybe that's something they'll want to add to their comfort menu too. Because when you do that, you actually really can make some significant changes in your health. So thank you all for joining us. A special thank you to you, Nick. It's just been a pleasure to have you on this evening. Thank you. Y'all go make it a healthy week.
The preceding audio may have contained the personal testimonials of some Take Shape for Life health coaches or clients. The results relayed in these messages are based on the unique experiences of the participants, and we cannot guarantee like or similar outcomes. While you may be inspired by these accounts, please note that any stories of success have not been verified, and your individual path to healthy living and weight loss will vary. As always, it is our recommendation that you consult with a physician before starting a weight loss program. Yours in health, the Take Shape for Life team.